Learning to solve problems with data structures and algorithms can be very difficult, and trying to figure out where to start when faced with a lengthy word problem can be anxiety-inducing. After solving countless HackerRank problems, LeetCode problems, and interview prep questions, I've sort of come up with a system for myself for tackling these problems. So today, let's talk about my approach to solving problems with data structures and algorithms. Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. I hope you guys are having an awesome day. And if this is your first time seeing me, hi, I'm Bree, and I'm really happy to have you here. So a few months back, I did a video explaining how I learned to think like a programmer. And a lot of the idea behind that video was talking about things that I either overthought or how I adopted a new way of thinking in order to be able to solve problems with programming. So some of the feedback that I got on that video was that it was more motivational and not as practical. So today I'm gonna be walking you through practically how I approach solving problems with data structures and algorithms. And I'm also going to be walking you through an example so that you can see sort of what my mindset is and what the physical things I do are. So if you're interested in that video, I will go ahead and leave a link up here, but let's go ahead and get into it. Solving problems with data structures and algorithms is usually a very large part of becoming a software engineer or software developer, not necessarily because we use this structure of problem in like our daily work, but mostly because a lot of companies integrate solving these problems with data structures and algorithms into their interview process, which means that you have to be able to solve a lot of these problems for most companies in order to be hired on as a software engineer. So I think some people would be surprised to know that I don't use a ton of data structures or algorithms in my daily work. That's just me. However, that doesn't mean that I'm not still responsible for understanding how data structures work and being able to apply them when I need to. Learning how to solve these problems is usually an integral part of learning how to code. And learning how to code is challenging enough by itself, and trying to figure out how to solve these problems that are almost like the lengthy word problems that I know a lot of us hated back in like high school and middle school, it can be really challenging. Even now, sometimes I still get nervous or still get a little bit of anxiety, even though I've seen tons of these problems. So let's talk about the steps that I take and the things that I do in order to solve these problems. So I personally like practicing on HackerRank. I think that they have a good range of questions. Regardless of whatever site you're using or whatever book you're using to pick out these problems, I think that these steps can be applied to any problem that you're trying to solve. So before I go ahead and get into it, I want to say, of course, everybody's different, so my way of solving a problem might be different than the way that you solve a problem. So today I'll be showing you how I would solve a problem from HackerRank, and it's called Cat and a Mouse, and I'm going to go ahead and leave it in the description in case you want to go ahead and take a look at it. And I'm purposely choosing one that's not too difficult because I don't want anybody who's taking a look at this who might not be as exposed to data structures and algorithm problems. I don't want you to get caught up in the nuance behind the actual problem, and I want you to focus more on my approach and steps to be able to solve the problem. Okay, so now let's talk about the steps that I take when I am going to be solving a data structures or algorithms problem. The first thing that I do is I prepare myself. Sometimes this means doing a few easier problems to just get like my mind juices flowing. I also like to have scratch paper and a pencil or like pen, whatever, available. I know some people like to take their notes on the computer. I like to like physically write things down though. So I always have something to write with and something to write on available. And I also go ahead and get another environment up. I personally like to use what's called RunJS, and I'll go ahead and leave a link below in case you want to check it out, but it just makes seeing my executable code a lot easier. I think HackerRank's interface isn't that great when you're trying to debug and see what's actually going on, so I like to write my code in RunJS, and then I just copy it over to HackerRank when I'm ready. The next thing that I do when I'm trying to solve a problem is I read the question for understanding. Now, you may think I'm crazy for even having to put this on here, but I know a lot of us can rush through and try to start coming up with solutions for the problem. Read the question in its entirety one time. Don't think about how to solve it. Don't think about what data structures to use. Don't think about any logic or anything like that. Don't take notes. Just read it so that you can understand it. After all, you can't solve a problem that you don't fully understand. Next, after you read the problem for understanding, we're gonna start back up at the top and then I usually read the question for clarity. So this is where I start to use my scratch paper. I write down any steps that I need to take, and I also write down any key variables and what their uses are. A lot of times with these very wordy data structures and algorithm problems, we're given a lot of information, but we don't always need all of the information. I know specifically with HackerRank, they will tell us every single variable that's being used. However, we don't need to use all of the variables. This will give me a clear idea of what I actually need and what I can just not worry about. This is also a great place to take note of any flowcharts that you need to go ahead and work through, or any branching conditions or any special conditions that you'll have to account for in your code. You should also take note of what your output should be and the data format that your output should be in. And then finally, in this step, I like to use the sample input and output that I'm given and walk through the logic, not through code or anything like that, but just step through the logic and understand how they're getting from point A to point B. This part alone has helped me so much in making sure that I am actually understanding what steps need to happen in order to get the output that's requested.
Okay, so when we take a look at our cat and mouse problem, we can come to the conclusion that our goal is to calculate the distance between both of the cats and the mouse to see which one will get there first or if they'll get there at the same time. So let's take a look at our inputs. According to this problem, we are given Q, which is the queries that we're going to be given. And please forgive my iPad writing. We're given X, which is going to be the starting position of cat A. We are given Y, which is the starting position of cat B. And we are also given Z, which is the position of the mouse. Now, based on the constraints that we're given, we know that these values are all integers, and they are between 1 and 100. So it's easier for me to just be able to see and correlate all of the different values for the variables with what they actually do. And then we also know for the output, we are going to be given, or false, we're not going to be given, we're going to be giving a string that is going to be cat A, cat B, or mouse C. And that's just a string that's going to go to the console and it's going to be printed there. Okay, so now that we have all of our inputs and outputs straight, we should go ahead and walk through one of the examples that they gave us. And in one of the examples, they gave us the query of 1, 2, and 3. And based on what we know about the queries, we can assign all of these values to our XYZ variables so that we know that cat A's position is going to be 1, cat B's position is going to be 2, and the mouse's position is going to be at 3. Now, something else they gave us is a plane that we can use for visual representation of where all of these items are. So let me just go ahead and get the plane together. 4 and 5. And please excuse my bad drawing. So if we take a look, cat A is going to be at position 1. We know that cat B is going to be at position 2. And we know that cat C is, or false, not cat C, the mouse is going to be at position 3. So let's just mark these A, B, and C to make things easier. So basically what we need to do is calculate the distance between the cats and the mouse. So if we're taking a look, cat A is 2 spaces away from the mouse, and then cat B is only 1 space away from the mouse. So providing that the cats move at the same speed, which they do, cat B is going to get to the mouse first. And that's exactly what our sample output says.
fourth thing I like to do is create a plan and start coding. So by this point, you have your sample input, you have your steps that need to be taken in order to get from point A to point B, and you also have any branching conditions, exceptions, extra logic, and everything like that. So basically now it's just time to put it in code. So what I like to do is I like to make comments in my code before I actually start coding. That way I can make sure that I'm basically like checking all of the steps of my logic off in my actual code when I'm programming. This is really where you can start to think about the exact data structures or pieces of algorithms that you want to use. So when I encounter something like two nested for loops, it can be really easy for me to think, oh, I need to optimize this, and I end up spending more time and sometimes get stuck trying to figure out how I can optimize it. Don't spend too much time figuring out how you can optimize a solution before you even have a working solution. Once it works, then you can go back and make changes. And then step five, we're going to refactor and repeat. So once your code works and you're getting all passing tests, then you can worry about refactoring some of your code. So this is the time to worry about your nested for loops or see if you can implement recursion or any sort of logic like that. This is also a great place to make sure that you use the correct data structure to solve the problem and make sure that all of your code is dry. Once you refactor and your solution works, you can submit it again, and then once you pass all tests, you can go back and refactor if you need to. And basically, you can just keep refactoring to make sure that things are optimized until there's nothing left to optimize. So what happens if you get stuck? Well, one, don't worry about it. It happens to the best of us. But here are some things that I do when I get stuck on a problem. The first thing I try to do is isolate the problem that I'm having. Am I in a situation where I'm stuck because I'm not understanding how the input and output are being calculated? If so, then I probably need to spend more time understanding the question. Like I said a little bit ago, data structures and algorithm problems are very tricky, and a lot of times people throw extra variables that we don't necessarily need to pay attention to in there just to throw us off. I am somebody who can easily get lost with a lot of numbers and a lot of variables, so this is really why I like to have my scratch paper available so I can take notes. Sometimes I run into a situation where I'm having trouble turning my logic into a programmable solution. So in these instances, the best thing that you can really do is break your problem down to a point where your problem can't be broken down anymore. For example, let's say I need to reverse the contents of an array without using any pre-built or auxiliary methods, and I'm getting kind of stuck. Here's the line of thinking that I would try to use to solve that problem. First, I know that I have an array and I'm going to need to use every single element within the array. That means that I can likely use a for loop to traverse the entire array. So since I know that I have to reverse the array and I'm going to be moving the contents to a new array, it would also be beneficial to start at the last index of the array that I have and work my way to the first index. This means that I'm gonna start at the last index in the array and subtract one from the indexes until I get to the first element. So what do I need to do in my for loop once I actually have the element? Well, I'm gonna need to move it to a new array. The easiest way to do this is to use the push method if you're using JavaScript, because it's gonna move it to the end of my new array. So this means that the element from the last index of my original array is gonna be at the first index of my new array. And my for loop is gonna keep running and keep doing that. And at the end, what I will have is an array of the elements of the first array, just in reverse. If I was having troubles with that, it's very likely that I was thinking about it in too broad of a light, but once I broke down each individual step, it was a lot easier to put all of those pieces back together. And the next thing that I usually do when I'm having some trouble is I research one piece of my problem and not the solution to the entire problem. Sometimes it can be really easy to want to look at the solutions and figure out what's wrong with your code, but that's not going to help you in the long run. HackerRank doesn't care if you've solved the problem. It's a learning tool. So if you are just inputting somebody else's solution into your code, you're not really learning anything. So once I've broken my code down into steps and I can see the exact piece where I'm having trouble, where I might be missing a piece of syntax, or I might not understand how I can turn the problem into like a piece of code, I look up just that one piece. And once I have that part, I try to continue working at the solution. A lot of times what happens for me is I just get like caught on one little thing, and then once I figure that thing out, it makes it so much easier to complete the rest of the problem. Solving problems with data structures and algorithms is hard. It just takes practice to know how you can best tackle these problems, and practicing really does make it a lot easier. You really just have to keep working at it. I would love to know what your approach to solving these problems is below, and let me know if this video was helpful for you. I always like to take a look at the comments that I'm getting and adjust my content to make sure that I'm being a great resource for you and the problems that you're having. So if there's anything else that I can do to talk about data structures or algorithms or any specific problems that you have, go ahead and leave them below. So that's all for today, but I can't wait to see you all in my next video.